Hello friends, welcome to the video lecture series on digital image processing. I am Dr. Dafda, and in this 31st video class of DIP, we will study the topic color fundamentals from the chapter color image processing for digital image processing. See, we live in a colorful world, and color is very important because it helps us to have better memories. Also, color helps us to store and process images more efficiently than colorless or grayscale images, and therefore we remember the colorful images better as compared to the black and white or grayscale images. See, in our previous video classes, we have developed different grayscale methods of image processing, and most of these methods are applicable to color images also, and some other methods require reformulation to be consistent with the properties of color spaces that we'll be learning further. So let us start. Now the first question that comes is, why do we use color in image processing? See, the use of color in image processing is motivated by two principal factors. Number one, color is a powerful descriptor which simplifies object identification and extraction. For example, face detection using skin colors. So in grayscale images, you will have difficulty in the detection. Number two, humans can discern thousands of color shades and intensities while only 24 shades of grays. So due to the structure of our eye, we can identify thousands of color shades. Okay, but in the grayscale image, we can hardly differentiate between 24 shades of grays. For example, let us see the image that we saw in the very first video class. This one is the color image, and this one is the corresponding grayscale image. And in this grayscale image, you can see that we just cannot identify what is the color of this spot. We even do not exactly know what these things are, which are nothing but sand particles. Also, the net in the background is not properly visible in the black and white image, and the color of the leaves looks almost identical. And you can see here, you can identify the net, the soil properly, the color of the pot, different colors of leaves. So you can see here that this color image is very powerful descriptor as compared to the grayscale image. Similarly, for this x-ray image of a thyroid phantom, you can see that the doctor will have difficulty in diagnosing from this image as compared to this image, which has got number of different color shades. So not only for machine image processing, but also for human image processing, the color is very important. The color image processing can be broadly categorized into two categories. First is full color image processing, and second one is pseudo color image processing. So as the name suggests, full color image processing will be processing the image that is captured with full colors. So here the images are acquired from full color sensors or equipments such as color TV cameras or color scanners, and it is used in publishing, visualization and the internet widely nowadays. For example, we have acquired this image with full color sensors, and after full color image processing get a enhanced image. So this is known as full color image processing. While for the pseudo color image processing, pseudo means false. So this means that false color image processing. So the images that are acquired for this pseudo color image processing are grayscale images only, and we are assigning some false color levels or color values to the grayscale image. So before few decades, the color scanners and processing hardwares were not available, and the images that were obtained or captured were black and white or grayscale images. And later, for the analysis, colors were assigned to a range of monochrome intensities like this. So for example, this image of a thyroid not gives us all the different ranges which are required by the doctor for the correct diagnosis. And here we are assigning different colors to different range of monochrome intensities, and hence such an image will be obtained that will be easier for diagnosis purposes. See, the process of interpreting or perceiving color is a very complex process that is not fully understood till date, but still the physical nature of the color can be explained by experimental and theoretical results. We have studied in our school days that in 1666, Sir Isaac Newton discovered that when a beam of sunlight passes through a prism, the light gets split into 7 different colors: V, I, B, G, Y, O, R, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. So below red we cannot see, that is known as infrared. Above violet we cannot see, which is known as ultraviolet. Infra means below, and red means red color. So below red is known as infrared, which is invisible, as well as ultraviolet means above violet, which is also invisible. Here it is shown that the color spectrum may be divided into 6 broad regions. So when we view in full color, no color in the spectrum ends abruptly, but rather each color blends smoothly into the next color. As you can see that this orange is blending smoothly into red. Similarly, this green is blending smoothly into yellow. And from this spectrum, you can see that the visible spectrum which the humans can see is composed of a relatively very narrow band of frequencies. So the visible wavelength only ranges from 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer. See, for an achromatic light source or monochromatic light source, there is only one attribute to describe the quality, which is the intensity, right? And therefore it is known as grayscale. Why? See, the name grayscale itself explains what it is. It is the different scale of gray, starting from white at one end to the black at the other end, and in between that different shades of gray, and therefore it is known as grayscale. Monochromatic means mono means single, and chrome means color. So monochrome means single color light, and that single color is nothing but white color, right? The absence of that white color is black color, and therefore it is known as monochromatic or achromatic, one which is not having color. But for a chromatic light source, there are three attributes to describe the quality of color. These three are radiance, which is equal to total amount of energy flow from a light source in watts. Next is luminance, which is equal to the amount of energy received by an observer in lumens or perceived by an observer. And see, these two are different. Why? Because if the energy or radiance is radiated in the infrared region, then the radiance will be in some watts, okay, but we cannot see it, and luminance will be zero, or lumens will be equal to zero. And most importantly, brightness is a subjective descriptor which is practically impossible to measure. The three important quantities to describe any color, see, previous discussed were the qualities, right? And these are the quantities, that means in what amount or the properties of color are hue, saturation, and intensity or brightness. So hue is defined as the predominant spectral color of any object. For example, red tomatoes has got red hue, right? So it is the predominant spectral color. Next, saturation means how pure the hue is, okay, or how less the white light is mixed with the hue, or you can say that saturation is how less the object is diluted by light. And as discussed previously, the intensity, brightness, or luminance is the subjective descriptor that is practically impossible to measure, right? So hue plus saturation will be equal to color or chroma or chrominance, and brightness is the luminance. So for color television, the luminance signal and the chrominance signals is sent separately. We have also learned in our school days that whatever we see in this world is just the reflection of the light, right? So the color that humans perceive in an object is equal to the light reflected from the object. For example, when the sunlight is falling on a tree or green leaves, the light that is reflected and is absorbed by the eye is the green light or green wavelength, which ranges in the range of 500 to 570 nanometer. You can see here the green is ranging from 500 to 570 nanometer. So only this wavelength will be reflected and perceived by the eye, whereas the other wavelengths will be absorbed by the seen. That means all the other range of energies is absorbed. Getting it, right? Let's go ahead. So in our second video class of digital image processing, we studied human visual system. And there we studied that the rods present in the human eye are responsible for the bright light, whereas the cones are responsible for the color light. So there are approximately 6 to 7 million cones in the human eye, and out of these, 65% are sensitive to the red light, 33% are sensitive to the green light, and 2% are sensitive to the blue light. But of course, this 2% is the most sensitive one. So you can see this curve of absorption of light by the red, blue, and green cones in the human eye as the function of wavelength. And you can see that the blue cones are most sensitive at 445 nanometer, green at 535 nanometer, and red at 575 nanometer. Although these are the values, CIE, that is International Commission on Illumination, have given these wavelengths for different lights in 1931. But of course, these are the approximate values, and these values should not be considered as the exact values. So these curves also show that any color is not made up of any single color. Okay, you can see here that blue is made up of this one, as well as this color, as well as this much this color. And the second important thing is that due to such behavior of human eye, these three colors are considered as primary colors that produce other colors. But of course, remember that not all the colors can be reproduced by using blue, green and red, as we will just see ahead, right? The secondary color are made by combining different colors. For example, green plus blue will make cyan, red plus green will make yellow, red plus blue will make magenta, and mixture of red, green and blue produces white light. And this shows the mixtures of pigments or subtractive primaries, you can say. For the subtractive primaries, yellow plus cyan will give us green, magenta plus cyan will give us blue, and magenta plus yellow will give us red. And the relationship between this colors and these colors are same. For example, you can see here that in between green and blue, cyan is present. Here also in between green and blue, cyan is present. Similarly, in between magenta and yellow, red is present. In between magenta and yellow, red is present. So these primary colors are known as RGB colors, and this subtractive primaries are known as CMYK, that is cyan, magenta, yellow, and K means black. So this one, subtractive primaries are used in printing industry. Why? Because there the background is usually white or white paper, and on that white paper you have to print the black ink, right? Whereas the RGB primaries are used for color televisions, where the background is usually black and you have to generate white on it, or the combination of different colors on it. Getting it, right? So the difference between primary colors of light versus the primary colors of pigment is that primary colors of pigment are colors that subtracts or absorbs a primary color of light and reflects or transmits the other two. Okay, for example, for the color of light, red, green and blue are there. For the color of pigments, it absorbs red and hence transmits cyan. So you can see here, it absorbs red and transmits cyan, that is green plus blue. It absorbs blue and transmits yellow, absorbs blue and transmits yellow, and absorbs green and transmits magenta, absorbs green and transmits magenta. Getting it, right? So as we have just discussed, the brightness is also known as luminance, and the hue and saturation taken together are called chromaticity or chroma or chrominance. Therefore, a color may be characterized by its brightness or luminance and chromaticity or chrominance. The amounts of red, green and blue needed to form any particular color are called the tri-stimulus values, and are denoted as capital X for red, capital Y for green and capital Z for blue respectively. And therefore, the trichromatic coefficients are given by small x is equal to capital X upon X plus Y plus Z, small y is equal to capital Y upon X plus Y plus Z, and small z is equal to capital Z upon X plus Y plus Z. And from these equations, we can deduce that X plus Y plus Z is equal to 1. In other words, this equation says that red plus green plus blue in suitable proportions will give white color. Now, using this CIE chromaticity diagram, we can specify different colors. So this diagram shows colors as a function of X axis, that is red, and Y axis, that is green. And for any value of X and Y, the corresponding value of Z or blue can be obtained by using the equation X plus Y plus Z is equal to 1. That means Z is equal to 1 minus of X plus Y. So for example, the point that is marked green in this diagram has approximately 62% green and 25% red. And from the equation Z is equal to 1 minus of X plus Y, blue is approximately 13%. Now here, the positions of various spectrum colors from violet at 380 nanometer to red at 780 nanometer are indicated around the boundary of this tongue shaped chromaticity diagram, and these are the pure colors of the electromagnetic spectrum. Now any point not actually on the boundary but within the diagram represents some mixtures of spectrum colors. The point of equal energy, which is shown here, corresponds to equal fractions of the three primary colors. It represents the CIE standard for white light, and any point located on the boundary of the chromaticity chart is fully saturated. So as the point leaves this boundary and approaches the point of equal energy from here to here, more white light is added to the color and it becomes less saturated, and the saturation at the point of equal energy is zero. Now this chromaticity diagram is very useful for color mixing. Why? Because a straight line segment joining any two points in the diagram defines all the different color variations that can be obtained by combining any two colors. Similarly, a line drawn from the point of equal energy to any point on the chart will define all the shades of that particular spectrum color. So you can see from the point of equal energy, if you go towards red, in between will come the pink, which is less saturated red color, or red color having white proportions in it. Now if you draw line segments in between blue, red and green, you will find all the different combinations of colors that can be produced using R, G and B. But you can see from this diagram that this triangle is not covering the colors which are present in this area as well as this area and this area. So these area colors are not present in the triangle that is drawn. So what this proves? This proves that not all the colors can be reproduced by using R, G and B. Getting it, right? So this triangle is known as RGB gamut of monitors. So monitors can produce all the colors only within this triangle. And the irregular region inside the triangle is a representation of color gamut of today's high quality color printing. So the boundary of this color gamut is irregular. Why? Because color printing is a combination of additive and subtractive color mixing, a process that is much more difficult to control than that of displaying colors on a monitor, which is based on the addition of three highly controllable primaries. So it is difficult to produce different colors on the printers as compared to producing different colors on the monitors or TVs. So that is all for this video class. Thank you very much.